So most of you might already know what is big data, but let me just reintroduce the term big data. So if the amount of the data is huge, or we call the volume of the data is huge, and the variety of data is also huge, and the velocity, which means the amount of data arrived in a given interval of time, if that is also huge, I'm just moving and yeah. So if volume, variety, and velocity, if these three characteristics of any data is huge, then we call that data as big data. So here we are going to deal with big data, and big data cannot be dealt with RDBMS, relational database management system, because they cannot scale horizontally in terms of hardware. So there will be definitely a limit if we try to scale vertically the hardware for RDBMS. And RDBMS will only work with structured data. So any data is called as structured if it has a schema. Schema consists of number of columns, and those columns are having different data types. And any data is called as structured data if all the columns in all the rows are having the same number of columns and in the same order. So that is the definition of a structured data. So RDBMS will only work with small data, and that also with structured data. So it can work with some gigabytes of data. But if the data crosses and goes into terabytes or petabytes, then we call the data as big data. But at the same time, it's not just about volume. It is also about velocity. Velocity means the speed of data getting generated. The amount of data that gets generated in a unit of time, that is called as volume or velocity. So if all these three V's, which are proposed by IBM, if all these three characters are having for a data, then that data is called as big data. And for processing big data, which can be for reporting purposes, or which can be for analysis, or which can be for research purposes. So if you are processing any data which is of big data, then we will be using non-RDBMS kind of tools or non-RDBMS technologies, which includes Hadoop. So Hadoop is a technology which is required to crunch the big data or to process the big data in a batch mode. So what is called as batch mode? If your data has to be processed at a regular intervals of time, and that data is not arriving at our location in a real time, then it is called as batch processing. So you will be crunching this data after every hour, or after every 3 hours, or after every one, after every day. So if you are crunching every hour, which means if any data is coming into the system, or any event is happening on a system, at, for example, if it is happening at 8 p.m., so that gets crunched at 9 p.m. and will come into the system after 9. So you can see any analysis which is related to an event happened at 8 o'clock only after 9 o'clock. So there is a maximum delay of 1 hour into the system. So that is called as batch processing. And there is other way of processing, which is called as real-time processing. In case of real-time processing, we will be getting the data into the system near to the real-time. So it will be only some milliseconds difference from the event happening on the system to the analysis happening on the system, and we will be able to see the analysis of that event happening almost near to the real time. So that is called as real time processes. And for real time processing, we use tools like Apache Storm. that is the interest of this group today, and we are going to discuss about Apache Storm. But if you have a requirement of batch processing, then we use Apache Hadoop. So Apache Hadoop is a technology which is used to process big data using batch processing. So let me, today we will be understanding what is Storm. We'll understand Storm architecture, components of Storm, and we will see how Storm really work. So we will be going through theory today, and tomorrow we will see some practicals. So in case of Hadoop, let me tell you a few terms in case of Hadoop. So in case of Hadoop, I'm just repeating, this is for batch processing. And we have two parts in Hadoop. One is HDFS, second one is YARN or MapReduce. So HDFS is for the storage of the data. YARN is for computing of the data or the processing of the data. So your hard disk will be used by HDFS, and your CPU and memory will be used by YARN. Okay. So YARN is a framework, or a MapReduce is a framework which is used to process your data, which is stored on HDFS. And here we are going to process data in batch processing, which means there is a delay in between the event happening on the system versus it is being shown in the analysis or in the reports. Okay. Whereas in case of Storm or real-time processing, there is no time difference or time gap from the time the data or the event gets generated to the event being shown in the analysis. Okay, so when I say there is no gap, there will be gap definitely, but that gap is very small. Normally it will be in some milliseconds. So that's why we call this as near real time. It's almost like a real time. Okay. So let me take an example in the industry I'm working and tell you where we use batch processing and where we use real time processing. Okay. So just stay with me because this might be new domain for you, but this helps you in understanding the things. So we have something called advertising exchanges, okay, or we can simply call them as ad exchanges. Okay. So what happens in case of ad exchanges is, any question Abuto, you have unmuted yourself.
Hey Ismail.
Yeah.
Yes. Hi Rini. Hey, please could you put mute in your... Are you mute? Okay.
Yeah. Thanks a lot. So advertisers will come to the ad exchanges. If you don't mute yourself, there is disturbance in the call and it's all recorded. So Angel Mota, please mute yourself. Yeah, thanks a lot. So advertisers will come to the ad exchanges to show their advertisements, and publishers will also come to ad exchanges to give the slots which are available on their pages to show the advertisements. So this is the business which happens in ad exchanges, and advertisers pay some money for showing their advertisements, and publishers will take some money to show these advertisements on the slots. And ad exchanges will allow to happen this by using ad platforms. Ad platform is a software and they keep some money, which is being exchanged between advertisers and publishers as commission. So that's how ad exchanges will make money. Now, every advertiser will have some ads, okay? And every publisher, so these are the advertisers, and every publisher will have some slots on the page, okay? So these ads will be shown on these slots if advertiser pays some money, okay? So he will pay some money, some dollars, and he will get paid some dollars, okay? Now, when this whole advertising is happening, at the end of every day, we will have a report saying that which advertiser has to pay how much and which publisher will get paid how much. So that is called as reporting. Okay, I'm just telling one more time. So we have reports which will say, which will tell us what is the amount that we have to pay to advertiser. Sorry, amount that has to be paid by advertiser. And also there will be reports for amount that has to be paid to publishers. So these are the two reports at least which should be available at the end of the day. But for example, if advertiser says that for my ad, budget is $1,000. So which means he's saying that I don't want to spend more than $1,000 on my advertisement. Okay. So now whenever you are going to show an ad, if you are going to say that only at the end of the day, I'm going to calculate how much an advertiser has to pay, then you may cross these $1,000. And because advertiser has a legal contract with ad exchange, he will not pay the extra amount. He'll say that legally I'm only bound to pay $1,000. He will not pay the extra money. So who is going to pay that extra money? Ad exchanges will incur those as losses in their revenues. So definitely ad exchange should know what is the available budget or what is the remaining budget at any given point of time. It should be real time, right? So ad exchange should know what is the leftover budget at any given point of time. So this is the location, or this is the scenario where we need real time processing. And every month end, we have to send invoices to advertisers and publishers. There we can use batch processing. So this is the place where we need real-time processing. And here for monthly reports, we need batch processing. So these are the two use cases you can easily understand where we need real-time processing and where we need batch processing. It is not correct to think that everywhere we can use real-time processing, because real-time processing will come for a cost. So we have to use real-time processing wherever we really need it, and wherever we can use batch processing, we can use batch processing, because if there is some problem in the batch processing while it is processing, we can stop and reprocess it. There is no problem. But in real-time processing, it will be a complicated task. So we can discard all the existing results of a batch processing, and we can restart in case of batch processing. So it's very safe to use batch processing. But that doesn't mean that we can use batch processing everywhere, because here we need the details almost near to the real time. So we have to use real time processing. So in this case, we can use for the batch processing, Hadoop, and here we can use Storm. So that's the difference between batch processing and real-time processing, and the technologies we select for batch processing is Hadoop, and the technology we select for real-time processing is Storm, or we can also use Spark, but today we are talking about Storm. So any questions till that place?
Yes, I have a question.
Let's move ahead. Okay. So as Diego and Hane explained, our use case in the company is about real-time processing. So we have selected Storm. Okay, so we will understand why we use Kafka in the upcoming classes. But let us understand what is Storm and how does it really help in doing the real-time processing. Okay, so we'll understand some terminologies so that actually from tomorrow, whenever we are using those terms, we all are on the same page. So what exactly is Storm? Storm provides you to do real-time processing, and whenever you are doing real-time processing, it is going to happen on a, in a distributed way. So what is meant by distributed way? So if you are from Hadoop background, you already know what is distributed way, but let me just reintroduce the term distributed. So distributed means actually a huge amount of work. When you have huge amount of work, that will be cut into several small pieces and will be done by multiple people. Here multiple people means multiple computers or machines or servers, and they will come back and finally give the complete result. So that is called as distributed computing. So you are computing in a distributed way. So the same thing will be done in Storm also. There is no difference in the terminology of distributed, but whenever you say there is a distributed system, you always talk about fault tolerance. Why? For example, if you are the owner of a company and if you are working for your own project, there will not be any problem because whatever the requirements you are coming to know, you are implementing that. There is no communication gap, there is no effort gap, all those things. But whenever you have a team and multiple people are working on the same project, it may happen that sometimes some of the people doesn't understand the requirements properly, or you are not communicating properly, or somebody is on leave. How do you have a risk mitigation for that kind of vacations or unplanned leaves? So all these things will come into picture when you have a team of people. So in the same way, in case of Storm or in case of Hadoop, whenever you're talking about distributed, you will be having multiple computers working together to achieve a job. And when you have multiple computers, there is a chance of losing one of the computer because of losing power or network connection, or you have some hardware problem. So it is quite possible to have that kind of problems. So any technology which is giving you distributedness should also provide you fault tolerance. If it doesn't give fault tolerance, which means your final result may or may not be correct. So Storm promises distributed and fault tolerance, and it provides real-time computation. So Storm will take care of how to handle the faults or how to handle the errors which are going to happen during the processing of the data. And it is an open source tool, which means you can go and modify the source and look at the source and modify it, and it's an Apache project. Storm is called as stateless, so which means it doesn't know what it has done previously, or there is no connection between the previous actions and the new actions on its own, but it maintains state using Apache Zookeeper. So Zookeeper is a component which is used by most of the distributed systems to save their state and to communicate between multiple machines. If one machine want to understand whether the other machine is up or not, whether it is running or not, it can understand that by going to the zookeeper, because every machine in that distributed cluster or in that distributed environment will go and write its state into zookeeper. So zookeeper is kind of registry or a register or a housekeeping book where these guys go and update themselves, update zookeeper about their health, about their status. So Storm also uses zookeeper. It won't keep any state in the Storm cluster. It keeps the state inside Apache zookeeper, and it will use this state and understand what is happening in the system in the cluster. Okay, so zookeeper is used, and zookeeper is a very standard way of maintaining the state or maintaining the logs in a distributed environment. Okay. So So this is the architecture of Storm. So we have two components in Storm. One is called as master node, and second one is called as worker node. You can think them as master and slaves. So Nimbus is the master node name. The service which is running on the master node is called as Nimbus. And on the worker nodes, supervisor is the service or the process which runs on the supervisor nodes. On the worker nodes, supervisor process will be running. And all the supervisors and Nimbus will understand about the state of other machines using zookeeper, which is shown here. And altogether, so we combine master and worker nodes. We combine all together and call it as Storm cluster. So cluster is a group of machines in simple terms. So there will be multiple worker nodes, and there is one master node as per this architecture. And we have zookeeper service, even though it is shown as one single box. But zookeeper itself is a cluster. It will be multiple machines. We will understand more about that in the upcoming slides about zookeeper. But here we are thinking it as a black box, which is useful for understanding the state of other machines. Okay. So we have Nimbus and supervisor process in Storm, and we use these Nimbus and supervisors to transform the data in real time. So let us go ahead.
Jagna, I have a question.
Yeah, Diego.
Which is the best practice for this architecture? Is to install in separate machines and Nimbus, then zookeeper, and then the worker nodes? Is that the best practice?
Correct. So zookeeper service, which is a cluster, should be completely separate from your Hadoop and Storm nodes. Okay, those should not be installed on any of these nodes which are related to either Storm cluster or your Hadoop cluster. And zookeeper is a independent cluster which is maintained at an organization level. Okay, and all these Nimbus and worker nodes are on different machines.
Okay, so the zookeeper nodes run in different machines that run Storm, master or worker, right?
Correct.
A question about a supervisor. Does supervisor process run in each node of worker nodes, right? And what is the process that connect the master with the worker nodes? How the master is communicating with the worker nodes?
Yeah, we will discuss that later in the slides. We are actually just introducing the terminology. first. Mm-hmm. We are not talking about the communication or what will happen if somebody goes down and that kind of scenarios.
Okay. Thanks.
Yeah. I'm actually taking it slow because everybody might not be the same level. So on the Hadoop cluster, we are just comparing it because we thought some of you might be from Hadoop background. Okay. So on the Hadoop cluster, we run something called MapReduce jobs, and in Storm, we run something called topologies. So if you are not from Hadoop background, I can just explain what is MapReduce job. So MapReduce job is the top level job which has set of tasks which has to be performed, okay, and it uses some data which is stored on the Hadoop cluster on HDFS, and it executes the transformations which are written in MapReduce job, and it will give the result back. Whereas in Storm, we call the top level entity called as topologies. So a topology is the top level entity. So if we want to do any transformations in Storm, what we have to create is topology. So if you want to do a transformation in real time, we are going to write a topology for Storm. Okay. And Arias, there is no problem in the voice. Please check why you can't hear me.
Hey, Christian, can you hear me? Christian, are you there? Do you have any question to Jagna? No.
Good. So in Storm, we have a top level entity called topology, and inside the topology, we write all the transformations. In Hadoop, we call that as MapReduce job. Okay. So, but there is a significant difference between MapReduce job versus topologies. So in case of MapReduce job, it's run once and stop. Whereas in case of topology, it's keep on running. It's like it will continuously run. Yeah, I think Christian is having some problem. So what happens is when you are talking about batch processing, you have a X amount of data which is accumulated. After that, your MR job or MapReduce job will come, and it will process this data or transform this data, and it stops. Okay, let me just write it. That will make some sense. From 8 p.m. to 9 p.m., you have some data. That data is arrived in HDFS, and at 9 p.m., your MR job runs and it processes or transforms some data, okay, and it transforms the data, and MR job exits. So it's finished. Whereas in real time, whenever you are processing real time, it doesn't happen like this. Your data will keep on coming. And whenever you are getting data, so every piece of data, whatever is coming into the Storm system, your topology will keep on transforms that data. and your topology will never exit, right? It keeps on continuing. Because this is real-time processing. This is not batch processing. Okay? So the difference between the batch processing and real-time processing is, in real-time processing we are using Storm, and in Storm the top level entity we use for transformation is topology, and it keeps on running, it will never exit. Okay. So in case of Hadoop, we have resource manager and node manager, and in case of Storm we have Nimbus and supervisor. So this is master and this is slave, or this is the worker in case of Hadoop. So normally you will be having one resource manager and you will be having multiple node managers, and here also you have one Nimbus and you have multiple supervisors. And whoever want to run his MapReduce job, he will come and execute the MapReduce job using resource manager, and resource manager will ask the node managers to complete that MapReduce job. And in case of Storm, the topology will be submitted to the Nimbus and it will assign the respective task to supervisors. So the point of contact in Hadoop for running a job is resource manager, and point of contact for running a topology in Storm is Nimbus.
Mm-hmm. Hey, Jagna, so the first paragraph is about Hadoop, and the last group, the three last lines is about Storm.
Storms,
right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and in your explanation, we don't see zookeeper, because zookeeper are relative to the status of the cluster, not for the transformation of the data, right?
Yeah, correct. So here we are only talking about the transformation of the data. So zookeeper will come into picture when these servers want to know each about the state for taking some decisions. Okay, so actually when we are running the topology, what happens if one of the supervisor goes down? Okay, then Nimbus should perform some activities. For that, actually it will go to zookeeper and get that. So that we will discuss later. But this is about the differences about the transformations, how the transformation happen in Hadoop and how the transformation happen in.
Okay. Thanks.
Sure, Digo, just a second. You can try now. You can unmute Digo.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, we can. Yeah. I have a question very quick here in the architecture for Storm. Which could you then, I think then we can go deeper about this. Could you provide best practice about this architecturing?
Yeah. So,
okay.
So once we complete the terminology, we will come to the best practices, Digo.
Great.
Okay. Yeah. So that's there. I'll add them to the slides also, because you have a requirement about that. Okay. I'll add to the slides in the upcoming slides as well. Okay.
About Jagna,
configuration. Jagna,
so okay. Sorry for the interruption. It's possible that you can record the sessions and later share with the team, or is not possible that? I don't know.
The session is already being recorded, and it will be shared by you. It will be shared to you by the support.
Oh yeah. You are saving, you are recording the session?
Yeah, this session
Or
is being recorded.
okay.
So all the sessions will be recorded and all the recordings will be given to you by the support.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks, sir. So in case of architecture, when we are discussing about architecture, we have seen the name of the processes. So we are saying that resource manager will be there, node manager will be there, or Nimbus will be there, supervisor will be there. But let us understand how internally the transformations will happen. So in case of Hadoop, you get something called job to the resource manager. I'm just calling it as RM here, resource manager. And resource manager will talk to multiple node managers. Okay, so here it will talk to multiple node managers. Here also there will be one more node manager, and it will give the task to this node manager. Task is like small piece of work which is being divided by the job. Okay, so job will be divided into multiple tasks, and those are assigned to multiple node managers. So this node manager is installed on one server, this node manager is installed on another server. So now this node manager will actually execute this task and give back the results to resource manager. But internally, this task is divided again into mapper and reducer. Okay, so here also it is divided into mapper or reducer. So this is more from implementation perspective. So the developer who is implementing the MapReduce job, he has to implement mapper and reducer. And similarly, in case of Storm, you have something called topology, and this topology will be given to Nimbus, and this will execute on multiple supervisors. So it will execute on supervisor 1 and it will also execute on supervisor 2. Okay, so supervisor 1, supervisor 2 doesn't have any difference other than those are running on two different machines. So here we have components called spout and bolt. So every activity or every transformation we have will have spout and bolt. Okay, so it is not real that every supervisor will get spout. I'll show that, but for understanding perspective, you can think that spout and bolt are the components of topology, and mapper and reducer are the components of job, map MR job, MapReduce job. So if you want to write MapReduce job, you have to implement mapper and reducer, and if you want to write a topology, you have to implement spout and bolt. So let us see what is spout and what is bolt.
Jagnan, could you please tell us the difference between Nimbus and Zookeeper in the architecture Storm, please?
Yeah, sure. So we have that. So here Nimbus is a master, so which takes most of the decisions, and worker nodes will just execute the transformations. It cannot take any decisions. We will, as we go further, we will understand more about what are the decisions which will be taken by the master nodes. So example, like it will take care of fault tolerance if one of the supervisor goes down, or if some of the data is duplicated, how to handle that kind of information. So all those things will be taken care by the master node. I think as we go ahead, we will see some scenarios where master node will take some decisions, or Nimbus will take some decisions. So the process is called as Nimbus, and it is called as master node because it is the master, and these will work as workers or slaves. Okay, but the process name is supervisor.
Okay, and the zookeeper there.
Yeah, zookeeper.
What is the function of the zookeeper?
Yeah, zookeeper is required because if one of the supervisor goes down. So how does Nimbus understands that some of the supervisor goes down? By talking to the zookeeper. So all these supervisors will keep on sending their heartbeats, not just heartbeats, actually it keeps on creating a session, active session with zookeeper. If that session is not there, then zookeeper knows that this supervisor is not up. So Nimbus then understands it's from the zookeeper. So there are something called zookeeper watches. So Nimbus can put a watch on the zookeeper service for the supervisor. So if this goes down, then an alarm is raised by the zookeeper and send it to the Nimbus, and Nimbus can immediately take a decision in that case, right? So we will see that scenarios. I think if I discuss all those things now, it may be confusing. That's why I'm not telling. I'm just introducing one term after.
Zookeeper is monitoring the status of the supervisor and communicate that to the Nimbus, right?
When you say monitoring, actually it's like a pull mechanism, right? Zookeeper is pulling. But it is not like that. Zookeeper gets this information from everybody. So it's a push mechanism. Everybody pushes the data to Zookeeper, and Zookeeper pushes only data related to alarms to the zookeeper agents. Okay. So in a loose terms, we can say it is monitoring, but not really monitoring, because monitoring is like push mechanism. It keeps on looking at everybody, and it polls, understands the information, right? That's monitoring. But zookeeper doesn't do that. But in a loose terms, we can tell that zookeeper is required for monitoring.
Okay, Jagna. Please could you return some minute to your notes?
You want to take some notes?
Yeah, your notes. You are writing some notes about you are explaining it.
This one?
That's in the MR job, task one and task two both are divided by resource manager, right? Both tasks belongs to the same job and are divided by resource manager.
Yeah. So even though I'm calling it as task one and task two, the logic doesn't, there is no difference in the logic. Actually, it's task one and task one, just copies. Okay. It's the same logic. What is different here is, here the data is different. So this task one is executing on data one, and this task two, this task one is executing on data two.
Okay.
Yeah. So the algorithm is same. It's not different. But the data is distributed in HDFS, right? So if you have 10 GB of data and you have 1 GB block size, so you will be having 10 blocks. And these 10 blocks might be residing in 10 different machines, if you have 10 different machines. Okay, so then the same logic, the task one, will be executed on 10 machines, but on different data parts. This is not a complete data, this is only data part.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Is that clear, or you need more explanation?
No, it's clear. It's clear. Yeah. Thanks. Mm-hmm. And it is almost the same case for Spode and Bolt.
It's slightly different.
It's a different data. Mm-hmm.
So I'll explain. Yeah, it's different. So in case of Storm, we understood that we will be using spokes and boards instead of mappers and reducers. So whenever you are writing a topology, you have to write spout and bolt. And in general, you will be writing a spout and multiple boards. So which means you can apply more transformations on a single piece of data. Okay. So let me explain you what is spout. Spout is a source. We have that in the next slide. So spout means it's a source of data stream. So why we are calling it as stream? So you call a stream of water if it continuously flows, right? So here data is flowing continuously. That's why we are calling it as data streams. It's a stream of data. It keeps on flowing. It will not stop at any point of time. Okay. So even if there is a gap in between, again it flows. There might be some gap, but again it keeps on flowing. So that's why it is called as data stream. And spout is the source of data stream, which means from spout you keep on getting the data, or the data is being transferred outside of the storm into the storm using spout. So whatever the data you have inside your application servers will be coming into the storm using spout. Okay. So, and on top of that spout, spout is only source of data. It is not transforming anything. So whatever it gets, it is going to send it to the bolt. And bolt is the task which actually transforms the data. So bolt can consume more than one stream and it transforms the data. Okay. So bolt is the actual logic in which we write the transformations. It can be joins, it can be group bys, anything in case of structured data. Okay. Yahin, please go ahead.
Yes, Yagna, a question about the functionality that offered bolt. You know, as HP Vertica offers SQL ANSI functionality to manage the data, what is the level? What is the level of how we can manage the data in bol? Is about is with Java functions, with Java code? Is about SQL functions that we can transfer the data in bol? How bol transfer the data?
We will see that during the exercises. We can the primary way to use is Java APIs. Okay, Java APIs to transform the data in bold. But we will see that during the demo tomorrow.
Okay.
Whenever we write some bold, we'll write a sample bold and try to see how it really works. Okay.
Yeah, so it's the unique point where we can transfer the data with bolts components in multiple bolts.
Yeah, we can transform the data. That's what the takeaway from today class.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
And spout can be of two types. It can be configured for unreliable and reliable. And in case of unreliable, it will send the data to the bolt and it will forget. Why do we do that? Is for the performance, because it won't wait for any acknowledgement from the bolt and it will just forget about that. But we may sometimes take decision for reliability, or most of the time we prefer reliability than performance, because if you lose some of the data, it may be a problem for our business. But for example, at any point of time, you think that performance is more important, even if you lose 1% of your data, then you can go and configure it for unreliable. But in case of reliable, it will wait for the acknowledgement, and if it doesn't get any acknowledgement, it will try to replay, which means it will again send the data to Bolt. Okay. So there are two kinds of spouts. One is unreliable and one is reliable. Okay. So what kind of spouts we see? In this example, we have a Twitter API which keeps on sending the stream of tweets. So we can use the Twitter API and create a spout, so which keeps on getting the Twitter tweet stream, and on top of that we can write some bolts, bolt 1, bolt 2, bolt 3 in a sequence or parallelly, and we can create, we can transform the data using the bolts. Okay, so bolt is source of data, and sorry, spout is source of data, and bolt is for transforming the data. And instead of data, we should call it as data stream, because it's continuous flow of data. So in this example, we are saying that we keep on getting the tweets, and spouts will send those tweets to bolts, and bolt will analyze the tweets or transform the tweets and get some result out of it. Okay, it can be group by or it can be anything. Okay. So we have covered this topology. So let us understand how to create a topology. So this is a sample topology we have created. All the square boxes or spouts and all the elliptical shapes is called as bolts. Okay, so here, see, the data is coming from spouts and it will be flowing to bolts. So it is going to bolt 1, bolt 2. The data whichever is coming from spout 1 is going to bolt 1, bolt 2. And the output of bolt 1, bolt 2 is going to bolt 4. And bolt 3 is accepting source from both spout 1 and spout 2. Okay, so in this diagram I want to show that bolt can accept data from multiple spouts, and bolt can accept data from other bolts, and spout can give data to multiple bolts. So there are three possibilities. Okay, I'm repeating. One bolt can accept data from multiple spouts. In this example, this bolt 3 is accepting data from multiple spouts. And one spout can give data to multiple bolts. And one bolt can accept data from other bolt. Fine. So these are the three ways to work with spouts and bolts. And now let us see. So this complete diagram is called as DAG, directed acyclic graph. So it is directed from here, data is moving here, and then from here data is moving here. So it's a directed, and you don't have cycles here, so acyclic graph. Okay. So you can create these DAGs, and this DAG is nothing but a topology. So this is a topology. Okay. And so what these bolts are doing, these bolts might be doing some transformations. We are calling them as function F, function H, and function G mathematically. So this bolt is transforming data which is coming from spout by applying a function F, and this bolt is transforming the data which is being given by spout 1 by applying a function called G, and the output of data after applying function F and function G is going to H. So the final result will be H. first you are applying function F on the data, and then you are applying function G on data, and finally you are applying function H on data. So for example, here you are using if you are familiar with SQL, if you are using where clause here and limit here, okay, and finally here you are using group by. So it's like first where clause will be applied, then at the same time you can apply limit, and you are going to apply group by here. So this whole thing is called as topology. So this DAG is called as topology. Any questions till the time?
So the topology depends of the business case that we have in order to resolve the transformations, right? So
yeah.
Depending of the complexity of business case, we can implement one or more bolts, right?
Okay.
And
yeah.
And also, I think, I don't know, please correct me if I'm wrong, it's about performance also. We can implement several bolts having the performance in mind or not.
Yeah. So most of the times actually the order of the bolts will change the performance. Okay. This we even see when we are doing SQL, right? If your SQL subqueries are, the order of those subqueries are changed, your SQL statement will take more time to execute, right? So it's same with bolts also. If some of the transformations are done first and then you have the other transformations later, it may take more time. For example, first you are group by and doing something and then you are applying where clause. It may take more time than first applying where clause and then doing the group by. So the order of the bolts does matter in case of performance. So we should also think of performance when you are designing the topology and implementing the topology. Does that answer your question? Yeah.
Yes, Jagna.
Yeah,
yes.
Thanks a lot. Digo, you can unmute yourself. I don't know how you are being restricted.
Yes, well, we would like to know also if, as you mentioned, you mean that if you have less number of bolts, it's going to have a best performance, is that right, in a topology?
No, I'm not telling that actually.
Okay.
So. Because you have different bolts for different transformations, okay, so it may not be possible to reduce the number of bolts, and most of the time we have more bolts to have intermediary data, so that if somebody else want to use this intermediary data, he can write another bolt connecting to this bolt. Okay, so that's how you decide number of bolts you should have in the system. So I can implement F, H, G, all the functions inside one bolt here. Okay. But I'm not implementing, probably because I have a use case where another function may use the output of bolt 1 other than bolt 4, and also another function may use bolt 2. So that architecture depends on your roadmap and wherever you want to use these intermediate results, you will write different bolts. So what I'm telling is the order of the bolts really, really matter in case of performance.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. So anyone else has any questions or you need more explanation on some of the points? please let me know.
Yeah, Yagna. In what case we have performance issues with this distribution? Maybe if the logic of the ball is very large, or when we have a lot of bolt components, we have issues with performance.
Normally, in most of the cases, it will be because of having more number of bolts in a wrong order. Okay, than having issues with single bolt. Because as a single unit, if it is a simple transformation, it will not hit the performance. But when we combine more bolts together, and if these are not put into correct order, or these are not put into a logical order, then we will either have a functional issue or a performance issue.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks. Real quick, Yagna. But it's not just having a lot of bolts, right? It's the order that matters the most, right? If, like you mentioned, if you do a group by before you do a where, obviously it's going to perform worse, right? So if
yeah,
maybe we need to focus on making sure our bolts are in usable pieces, but also in the correct logical order.
Yeah. So also, when you have more number of bolts, Justin, you are keeping a lot of data for further use, right? For example, here in this case, the output of the bolt 1 will not be discarded. Okay, so this will be there. Even though bolt 4 is using, still it will be available for another bolt. So if you don't have that kind of use case, don't keep these as two different bolts. You keep them as single bolt. But if in your roadmap, if you don't have any bolts now, but you in your roadmap, you are going to implement another bolt here, so definitely you have to keep this as a separate bolt, because you cannot crunch again the spout, the data coming from the spout, and create the input for bolt 5, okay, which is an imaginary bolt which will come in the future, right?
Sure.
So the number of bolts, actually we have to decide. That's more from a visionary perspective. We should be able to create more bolts if required.